I'm pretty sure you're familiar with the popular situation in which, when a person is in trouble and asks someone for advice, the answer is, follow your heart, or listen to your heart. Well, it would seem that that piece of advice is not so far from the truth. There are many cases in which heart transplant recipients described a personality change, reporting they have acquired the tastes, emotions, and even the memories of their deceased donors, and I'll present some of those cases in this video. I assure you that, as with all the other videos found on my channel, it is worth watching until the end. I will also make a second part to this video, in which I'll present several scientific explanations for this intriguing phenomenon, so if you haven't done it already, make sure you subscribe and tap the notification bell. So, without further ado, let's get started. In 1988, Claire Sylvia, a health-conscious dancer and choreographer from Hull, Massachusetts, undergo a heart-lung transplant procedure, becoming the first person in New England to have this type of surgery. 5 months after the transplant, Sylvia had a vivid dream about a tall, thin, young man, whose first name was Tim, and whose last name began with L. As she later wrote in her book, A Change of Heart, published in 1997, we kiss, and as we do, I inhale him into me. It feels like the deepest breath I have ever taken. And I know at that moment, the two of us, Tim and I, will be together forever. I woke up knowing, really knowing, that Tim L. was my donor, and that some parts of his spirit and personality were now in me. Shortly afterward, Sylvia began to have a craving for beer, which she hadn't particularly been fond of, and she developed an uncontrollable urge to eat chicken nuggets, a food she never ate. She found herself drawn toward cool colors and no longer dressed in the bright reds and oranges she used to prefer. She began behaving in an impetuous and aggressive manner that was uncharacteristic of her, and even her friends noticed she started to walk more like a man. Sylvia heard from a nurse that her donor was an 18-year-old boy who died in a motorcycle accident, but the hospital refused to tell her more, because apart from information such as gender, age, and cause of death, profiles of organ donors are traditionally concealed from their recipients for psychological reasons. At first, Sylvia accepted the advice to leave well alone, but she continued to experience disturbing, unfamiliar feelings and appetites. It was, she wrote, as if the very center of my being was not fully mine. She found herself attracted by rounded, blonde women, as if some male energy in me was responding to them, and she began experiencing an increased libido, stronger body odor, restless energy, and a craving for junk food. The surgeon had put her body back together again, but not her emotions. In Sylvia's words, that new, reconstructed person just wasn't me. Searching for an answer to her traumatic breaking apart, Sylvia, who described herself as sensitive, intuitive, and open to psychic phenomena, began keeping a record of her dreams about the mystery man named Tim L. and sought help from a Jungian analyst. She consulted a range of what she called open-minded scientists. Several came up with the notion of cellular memory, meaning that the cells of our bodies are instilled with our memories, as in the homeopathic concept of memory of water. And she began to be interested in the Eastern concepts of energy, or chi. She even opened herself to the idea that after a fatal accident, the spirit of the victim gets stuck, so she resorted to the work of healers who claim that they can free the donor's organs at the time of transplant. It was not until 1990 that she traced the identity of her donor through his obituary in a local paper. Just as it appeared in her dreams, the donor's first name was Tim, and his last name began with L. Tim Lambrand, from Saco, Maine, who died when he was only 18 years old, after his motorbike crashed into an oncoming truck. Interestingly, uneaten Kentucky Fried Chicken nuggets were found in the jacket of the donor when he was killed. When Sylvia eventually visited his family, she learned that he had been restlessly energetic, with a love of chicken nuggets, junk food, and beer. Sylvia's experience is described in her book, A Change of Heart, written with William Novak, whose previous autobiographies include those of Nancy Reagan and Oliver North, which was published in 12 languages and made into a film, Heart of a Stranger, starring Jane Seymour. Another extreme case was presented by Dr. Paul Pearsall, a psychoneuroimmunologist and neuropsychologist at the University of Hawaii, in his book, The Heart's Code, Tapping the Wisdom and Power of Our Heart Energy, published in 1997. According to Dr. Pearsall, during a meeting held in Houston, Texas, by an international group of psychologists, psychiatrists, and social workers, a psychiatrist described a case that disturbed her so much that she struggled to speak through her tears. She said she had as a patient an 8-year-old little girl who received the heart of a murdered 10-year-old girl. After the transplant, the recipient began having recurring vivid nightmares, and she was screaming at night about her dreams of the man who had murdered her donor. Her mother arranged a consultation with the psychiatrist, who, after several sessions, concluded that she was witnessing actual physical incidents. The psychiatrist and the girl's mother decided to call the police, and, using the description from the little girl, they found the murderer. He was easily convicted with evidence the transplant recipient provided: the time, the weapon, the place, the clothes he wore, what the little girl he killed had said to him. Everything the transplant recipient reported was completely accurate. In 2000, Dr. Pearsall published a controversial paper in which he described a set of 10 representative cases out of over 74 transplant procedures that have been brought to his attention of recipients who had received heart or heart-lung transplants. The paper was co-authored by Dr. Gary Schwartz, professor of psychology, surgery, medicine, neurology, and psychiatry at the University of Arizona, director of the Human Energy Systems Laboratory and director of the Center for Frontier Medicine and Biofield Science, both at the University of Arizona, and Dr. Linda Rusek, co-director of the Human Energy Systems Laboratory at the University of Arizona, and who has been director of the Harvard Mastery of Stress Follow-Up Study since 1978. Researchers conducted open-ended interviews with volunteer transplant recipients, recipient families or friends, and donor families or friends in hospitals in various parts of the USA. Several parallels per case were observed between changes following surgery and the histories of the donors. Parallels included changes in food, music, art, sexual, recreational and career preferences, as well as specific instances of perceptions of names and sensory experiences related to the donors. From the case of a 24-year-old female who turned a 25-year-old male into a lover, who likes to cuddle all the time and go shopping at the mall slinging his purse over his shoulder, to the case of a 14-year-old girl who was a gymnast and turned a 47-year-old man into a teenager, who has, as he put it, the annoying tendency to giggle that drives my wife nuts, and who, according to his brother, yells and jumps around like a fool, even when he's bowling. The study shows a very high transfer of personality traits that immunosuppressant drugs, the stress of surgery, or statistical coincidence cannot explain. One of the cases is that of a boy who loved music and poetry and who was killed in a car accident when he was only 18 years old. His parents waited more than a year to clean his room after he died, and they found a book of poems he had never shown them, and they told no one about it. The recipient, an 18-year-old girl, was, according to her father, a hellraiser. After the transplant, she became quite quiet, and she told her mom that she wanted to take guitar lessons, the same instrument the donor had played. Moreover, when the donor's parents met the girl and played her some songs composed by their child, she was able to finish the phrases of the songs, even though she had never heard them before. In another case, a 47-year-old Caucasian foundry worker received the heart of a 17-year-old African-American male student who died during a drive-by shooting. In the interview, the recipient said that after the transplant, he began to love classical music, which until then he hated. "I know it's not my new heart, because a black guy from the hood wouldn't be into that. Now it calms my heart. I play it all the time. I more than like it. I play it all the time," said the man after the transplant. The recipient's wife said that after the surgery, her husband, for the first time, he's invited his black friends over from work. He seems more comfortable and at ease with these black guys, but he's not aware of it. "And one more thing I should say, he's driving me nuts with the classical music. He doesn't know the name of one song and never listened to it before. Now, he sits for hours and listens to it. He even whistles classical music songs that he could never know. How does he know them? You'd think he'd like rap music or something, because of his black heart." However, unbeknownst to the recipient, the donor actually loved classical music, and the other kids always made fun of the music he liked. He was accidentally shot while walking to violin class, and he died on the street, hugging his violin case. Another case shows the changes in the personality of a 29-year-old woman after she received the heart of a 19-year-old girl who died in an automobile accident. The donor's mother said that her daughter owned and operated her own health food restaurant, and she was scolding her constantly about not being a vegetarian. She reported that the girl was able to write some notes to me when she was dying. She was so out of it, but she kept saying how she could feel the impact of the car hitting them. She said she could feel it going through her body. The recipient reported, "You can tell people about this if you want to, but it will make you sound crazy. When I got my new heart, two things happened to me. First, almost every night, and still sometimes now, I actually feel the accident my donor had. I can feel the impact in my chest. It slams into me, but my doctor said everything looks fine. Also, I hate meat now. I can't stand it. I was McDonald's biggest moneymaker, and now meat makes me throw up. Actually, when I even smell it, my heart starts to race. But that's not a big deal. My doctor said that's just due to my medicines. I couldn't tell him, but what really bothers me is that I'm engaged to be married now. The problem is, I'm gay. At least, I thought I was. After my transplant, I'm not. I don't think anyway. I'm sort of semi or confused gay. I think I got a gender transplant." The recipient's brother said that, "Susie's straight now. I mean it, seriously. She was gay, and now her new heart made her straight. She threw out all her books and stuff about gay politics and never talks about it anymore. She was really militant about it before. She holds hands and cuddles with Steven, just like my girlfriend does with me. She talks girl talk with my girlfriend, where before she would be lecturing about the evils of sexist men. And my sister, the queen of the Big Mac, hates meat. She won't even have it in the house." If you want to read the detailed description of the cases presented by Dr. Pearsall, I placed the link to the study in the description of the video. Changes in the personality of the recipients after heart transplants have been reported in many other studies around the world. Dr. Benjamin Bunzel, from the Department of Surgery at the University Hospital in Vienna, Austria, has investigated the cases of 47 patients who were transplanted over a period of 2 years. Although most of the patients showed massive defense and denial reactions, mainly by rapidly changing the subject or making the question ridiculous, 15% stated that their personality had indeed changed, while 6% reported a distinct change of personality due to their new hearts, adding that they felt compelled to change their prior feelings and reactions to accommodate those they sensed as coming from the memories of their donor. Characteristics of those describing personality changes attributed to the donor include: environmentally sensitive, sensual, animal-loving, music-loving, creative, and the type to be inclined to go with the flow rather than dominate. Another study of 35 males, published in 2004 by Yoram Inspector from the Shalvata Psychiatric Center Israel, showed that even in the years following a successful heart transplant, recipients reported a high level of stress, and 73% of recipients felt that acquiring a new heart had had a dramatic influence on their lives, with a new appreciation of the preciousness of life and a shift of priorities toward altruism and spirituality. So, what could it be the explanation for this intriguing phenomenon? Scientists don't have yet a definitive answer, but in the next part of this episode, we'll look at some of the possible explanations. As always, thanks for watching.